that's a warm up for later. Y'all remember that. Let's stand and sing. Come, people of the risen King. Here we go.
Welcome to worship. You may be seated. Let me say that again. I said that a little bit too quick. Welcome to worship. You know, as we gather, I was thinking about the weather that we've had this week. Bree Smith on Channel 5 has watched her, and she pointed out that in a week we've had record heat, tornadoes, record snowfall, single degree temperatures, And now we're having all this rain. And all of this is happening. But in the world around us, and there are a lot of things happening in the world around us, but when God's people gather to worship, we gather to share a single thought, a single mind, and that is to rejoice in God and who he is, and to worship him for who he is and for what he's done. You know, it doesn't matter where you came from. It doesn't matter what you've come through to get to this point. We can all gather to worship because God has done a wonderful work in our hearts. And this is why we gather to worship. And we're so glad that you're here with us. We have some special guests with us today. Rob Burdett is our new director of missions for our association. For those of you who are unfamiliar with that, we as First Baptist Ridgetop are a member of an association of churches where we cooperate together in doing mission work and supporting one another. And as director, Rob's, what is your job description? No, Rob's responsibilities are to coordinate all of that and to support the churches. And I'm talking with Rob, and he and his family are unique. Here we are, we're emphasizing our Lottie Moon here in January, and Rob and his family just came off of the mission field from Thailand. And we're going to tell you some more about that later, and Rob's going to tell you some more. But we're blessed to have he and his family, and I'm going to let him introduce his family. We're blessed to have them this morning as we gather. As we continue our worship, though, let's worship in prayer. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you. You are the God of glory. You are the God of heaven and earth. You are Lord, Father, of all that we see, of all that has been created. Jesus, your word tells us that all things were created by you and for you. Father, that includes us. And so we worship you. Lord, may this worship be filled with your spirit and your truth. Father, may those who don't know the grace that came from the cross through your son Jesus, may they experience that grace today. Lord, you are a wonderful God. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand. As you're able. And I'll do this time. men of faith, rise up and sing of a great and glorious King. You are strong when you feel weak, in your brokenness complete. Shout to the north and the south, sing. Up, church with broken wings, fill this place with songs again of our God who reigns on high. By his grace again we'll fly. Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west, Jesus his Savior. Sing to the east and the west, Jesus.
that didn't work. As I said earlier, Rob and his family were missionaries to Thailand for 8 years, that I think is what I remember. As we're focusing on our giving to the Lottie Moon offering this month, I think it's good to understand exactly what that money is going to. And 100% of what you give through this offering goes to missionaries like Rob and his family, and there are other missionaries that are on the field. I think there are over 5,000 missionaries around the world that we're supporting through this. And so Rob's going to come, and he's going to share a message and tell us a little bit about what they did on the field.
There we go. It takes a team to get me ready. There we go. There we go. Well, we are the Burdettes. I wanted to introduce my family to you first. I want to introduce my wife, Nicole. Y'all stand up, girls. They love to be singled out in public. That's their favorite thing. So this is my wife, Nicole. She's going to pray for us in Thai in just a little bit. My youngest daughter, Kate, middle daughter, Olivia, and oldest, Ellie. And so we have served for the last 8 years in northern Thailand, with the International Mission Board of Southern Baptist, affectionately called the IMB. We have a little short video to show. Is that going to be possible? We just want to show you, give you a picture of some of the people we work with, some of the places. Just real short, just 3 minutes.
For your ways,
for showing. That gives you just an idea of the people we were working with and some of the places we got to go and everything. And so we served with IMB for 8 years, and now I'm the new director of missions for Robertson County. And I've been doing that for about 3 weeks, so I got it all figured out. You know, piece of cake, piece of cake. One of the things I am doing as a part of my job, of course, is praying for the churches. So I have a prayer wall, and I like to pace and pray. And so I have a picture of each church, but I just have your church building. And so I thought, man, I mean, I understand that represents the church and where you gather to worship and minister, but it'd be great if I could have a picture of the people. So with your permission, if you'll let me, I'm going to take a picture of you guys, and I'll put it on my wall so I can actually pray for the church. Now, I know some folks aren't here, and some people aren't happy with their hair or whatever, but just this is, we're all friends. I'm just going to take a picture of you, and just know that I'll be praying for your church and how God is working here. So let's get the old phone out here. Everybody, let me get everybody in. Everybody make a big smile. If you have any warrants out, just duck your head. We don't want to get anybody in trouble. All right, on the count of three. One, two, three. Oh, there we go. We got some celebration in the back. Let's do that again. One, two, three. There we go. So now I can pray for you guys instead of just praying for the building. Well, as I said, we served for 8 years overseas, and I was talking with my dad now that we're back, and he said, since you've been gone, you know, what was the one thing you missed the most? And I said, Dad, I miss beef. And he said, well, thanks, son, we missed you too. So I said, well, we miss family, we miss family, but I missed beef. It's very hard to get beef and good beef there. The beef they have is water buffalo, got kind of a skunky taste. So whenever I could get beef, I was really excited. After our first term there, I actually had a doctor prescribe me beef. I have a medical prescription that says eat more beef because I was anemic. My iron was low, and says, hey, you need to eat some beef. It was the best doctor trip I ever had my whole life. I kept that prescription to eat that beef. So it's been great to be back. I've already gained like 20 pounds in, you know, just several months being back because the food's so good here. But food was good in Thailand, just no beef. And so I want to teach y'all some Thai this morning. Very important. Very important part of missions is being able to order in a restaurant. So I want to teach you this one phrase, okay? So I want to teach you the phrase Kai Dao, all right? So in just a second, we're all going to say the term Kai Dao. And when we say that, when we say Kai Dao, we're going to do our hand like this, okay? We're going to go Kai Dao, okay? So ready? On three. One, two, three. Kai Dao. And what we just did is we just ordered a fried egg to be put on top of our food. And that's crucial. That just changes everything to get a nice egg. You can put it on top of your curry, put it on top of your fried rice, put it on top of your sandwich, whatever you get, you just get it. Kai Dao, do that. They'll put you a nice egg on there and it just, you know, takes everything up a notch. So it's always important to have to have some good food there in Thailand. But we had a blast there. The owners of the restaurants, they loved us. They thought I was like a circus animal. As you can see, the height difference between me and Thai men. Average Thai man's about 5'8", 5'9". And I was in the country for 3 days, and I broke two chairs and a toilet seat. So that country wasn't made for somebody my size. So, you know, it was difficult. Literally, there was one time my family, we were at a pancake house at a breakfast place, and we ordered, and the waitress said, you've ordered too much food. And we said, well, that's okay, we'll just take it home. And we started eating, and about the time Kate, when she was about 5 years old, she polished off the whole big stack of pancakes. The owner of the restaurant came out and apologized to us. She said, I'm sorry, we just didn't believe anybody could eat that much food. So that's a true story. So a true story of we ate good while we were there. We didn't get beef, but we did eat good. But everything wasn't fun and games, though, there in Thailand. The area we were at was in northern Thailand in Chiang Mai, and it's a part of an area known as the Golden Triangle. You may have heard that term because all of the world's drugs, with the exception of cocaine, comes from the Golden Triangle. Number one producer of all drugs except for cocaine comes from the Golden Triangle in this part of the world. It's also an area of great violence as drug lords and corrupt governments and different things fight, and people are hurt in the crossfire. It's a hub for sex trafficking, and it is a place of great spiritual darkness. And so that is the Golden Triangle, and that was our mission field. That's where we were at. But we're here today to testify and to tell you, in spite of all that, in spite of the drugs and the violence and the human trafficking and the spiritual darkness, we were eyewitnesses to what God did. And that God was at work and did great and mighty things, and that there were many who came to faith and to believe. And so today, the purpose of my message today is just so we can celebrate and give praise to God of what He has done in Thailand, but what He is doing all over the world. That He is the God of the whole earth. Before we look at our text this morning, I thought it might be nice. I wanted to get my wife involved, and so she's going to come and she's going to pray for us in Thai. And the great thing is that the Lord understands. We may, you know, everybody may not understand, but the Lord does. And so she's going to pray for us in Thai. So let's pray together.
Pray.
Yeah.
Okay.
There we go.
Ka te pravida jau, ka kum pra jau samrap wan ni. Timi okat ma namasagam pra jau duigan ka. Ka pra jau chui kun rob wela prakat kao prasut. Prasut chat. และทุกคนเข้าใจค่ะขอพระเจ้าช่วยทุกคนเพื่อใจด้วยค่ะขอพระเจ้าอวยพรทุกคนที่นี้และช่วยทุกคนมีชีวิตให้เกียรติพระเจ้าเราอธิษฐานในนามพระเยซูคริสต์เจ้าอาเมน
อาเมน Thank you. My wife, she had excellent time. We bothpassed our test that we're fluent, but I did much better in restaurants for some reason. You know, I was an expert when it came to the supper table and ordering in Thai and doing things, but my wife was excellent in speaking Thai. I want to invite you to open the Word with me this morning to Psalm 24. Psalm 24, I think everybody knows the 23rd Psalm, the Lord is my shepherd. Well, one right after that is Psalm 24, and this is a great message, and this passage has a lot of significance to my family. This was a chapter that we memorized together as a family one year. And so I want to encourage you all, if that's not something you're currently doing, is to memorize Scripture. It's a great way for us to hide God's Word in our heart so that we can know it in times of trouble and just to meditate upon it and ruminate on it. And so this would be a great one for you to choose if you don't have one yet. For the coming year, a passage to memorize here about the greatness of God and His glory throughout the earth. So I'm going to read Psalm 24 for us. Oh, I think I lost something. Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For He founded it upon the seas and He established it upon the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in His holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to an idol or swear by a false god. He will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God his Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek Him, who seek Your face, O God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is He, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty. He is the King of glory. A very famous passage giving glory to God. And a couple of things we want to get from this morning we want to look at. The first is, right there from verse 1, we want to see that the earth and all its people belong to God, that God is sovereign over everything and over everyone in it, over everyone in the world, that God is not the God of just a region or an area or one people or one nation or one race or one group or one language, but He is the God of the whole earth, everything in it and everyone in it, that He is not limited by region or place. Now, in the Old Testament, you might remember a story in 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 28. The Arameans were going to fight against Israel. And they came up with their battle plan, and they said, let's fight them in the plain. Because their God is mighty, but he's a God of the mountain. And so we don't want to fight them in the mountains. Let's draw them out into the plains, because then that's where they'll be vulnerable, because their God, he won't be there. Well, of course, Israel was victorious, and after this battle, God declares that he's not only the God of the mountain and of the plain and of the sea and of the air, of everything, that he is the God of the whole earth, that the earth is his and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. And we see that in the history of religions across the world, that this is the way that people have created religion to put gods in a box, to put them in certain areas. We see this in Roman mythology, like you would have Venus would be over love, and then Mars would be over war. Or we see it in Norse mythology, that you'd have Thor, he'd be the god of thunder and lightning, and Freya would be the god of the hearth and of harvest. We see this in the Old Testament, where Baal was the god of fertility, and Asherah was the god of the rains and the harvest. And in Egypt, Ra, the god of the sun, and on and on and on. This is a common practice that we see in the gods that people have created for themselves, that they put them to a limited area or scope that they have power. But the God of the Bible rejects that outright. He says that the entire world and everything in it is his and belongs to him, that he is sovereign, that everything is his. And we see this still goes on today. Even in our modern world, we like to compartmentalize things, compartmentalize areas, and say, in this area, God is sovereign and in control, but not so much here. We do it a lot. You'll hear people say, oh, well, this is sacred, but in the secular world, it's this way. In the secular world, and people use that term to as if there's a world separate from God and his reign and his rule. Well, God rejects that. That the Bible teaches that the secular doesn't exist, that the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. We see this a lot. There's two areas I see it a lot. Is one is in business, the marketplace. People say, well, this is the secular world. Well, you know, when we read in Scripture, God has a lot to say about the business world, about the marketplace, and how we should be fair and just and not be corrupt in our practices. That God, he's the Lord even over the marketplace and how we as Christians should conduct ourselves there. We also see it in the realm of politics. A lot of times people will say, oh, well, this is the secular world. Well, all throughout Scripture we see God give commands of rulers, how they should rule, and leaders, how they should lead, and what are good laws and what are bad laws. That God is sovereign over all things. That simply saying it's secular or saying us trying to put him in a box does not confine him, because the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. That everything is very reminiscent, like Brother Ralph said in his prayer from Colossians 1, 16 and 17. Everything was created by him and for his purpose. On heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or government, all things created by him and for his purpose. Even bad governments, not that he made them bad, but that he uses things in the world for his good and for his plan. That nothing in this world can thwart him or stop what he is going to do. Not superpowers like Egypt in the Old Testament, not Babylon, not Rome, not in our modern world, not Russia, not China, not the U.S., that God is sovereign overall, that all things and all areas of life belong to him. The second part of that is that the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it, all the people. God has a heart for all peoples and all nations, that they would glorify him and that his name would be echoed throughout every nation on the earth. We've been blessed to get to see that. To get to see people come to faith from all different places. Most missionaries work with one people group. They have a laser-like focus to work with that one group because that's the best way to reach that group. But we were privileged. We worked with the theological training team. And so we got to work with a lot of different groups of people to help them, to help pastors and church planters, and to teach them the Scripture and to teach them the methods for planting churches and doing that. We got to work with Thai church planters, and that was really awesome. We got to attend a Thai church And you got to see some of them in the video there that were baptizing. Those are church planters and pastors that we worked with. I got to work at a seminary. I taught New Testament for the Corinne people group. I'm wearing a Corinne shirt this morning. And you'll see this is like the second or third one I had to have made. The lady that made it for me, she didn't believe. She measured me, and then she didn't believe the measurements, and she made it too small. So I said, just make it like a trash bag. We just got to get it all over, you know, all of this. And my wife, she has a lovely Corinne dress on, but we would go there and worship with them, and I would teach at the seminary, and it was a great time there. We got to go into migrant camps to work with the Shawn people, very poor, and got to work with them there. So we got to work with several different people in Thailand, but we also got to work with other groups of people outside of Thailand. I got to work with some missionaries in Cambodia, which neighbor Thailand. And my buddy who works with the IMB, he's like, Rob, it's like the book of Acts comes alive every day. He was out in the bush of Cambodia, and he says, you just wouldn't believe just the things, the miraculous things that we see. He's like, he went to Southwestern at Fort Worth, and he's like, they didn't teach us this there. There was a friend of mine who's a doctor. He said he prayed for a lady. A lady had died. He pronounced her dead. And everybody said, well, pray for her. We want to see if God will do something. Let's pray for her. And he said he prayed for her. And he was like, you know, Lord, be with the family as they grieve. And he said, I didn't pray anything good. I was just like, be with the family. She's dead. I've already pronounced her dead. That was on Saturday night. On Sunday, she was in the front row of the church. He said, I've never seen anything like it. He said, I don't know how to explain it. And this is not a quack. This is a Western doctor. He said, the book of Acts coming alive every day. I got to work with missionaries in Pakistan and see baptisms on the roof of houses where they had to have them in water tanks. In Islamabad, the same city where SEAL Team 6 came and got Osama bin Laden. Well, the gospel was there even before SEAL Team 6. And they were baptizing people on tops of the houses there. Into the water tanks. We got to work with missionaries in India that had their churches burned, and they would do house churches out of fear of other people and the persecution burning down their churches. And they now have the largest home church network in the history of Christianity is in India, working through overcoming those obstacles because God is faithful. And I got to work with a guy in UAE and the United Arab Emirates in the Middle East who would sneak across the border into Saudi Arabia, where Christianity is illegal by the government. He would sneak in and lead worship for small home groups. And he'd tell you they'd have three or four in a house, and he said, man, the praise was so amazing. It was like they were going to blow the roof off because their heart just so yearned to worship God and had to be so secluded and so secretive. But what I hope to see in this is that the Lord is worshipped all over the world, and that the name of Jesus is lift up in praise in spite of the persecution, in spite of the governments, in spite of the religions, in spite of the companies, in spite of the family persecution, all the things coming against it, that the name of Jesus is lifted up. Because the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. That he is the God of all people and of all nations. The second thing we want to see from this passage is the foolishness or the folly of trusting in an idol or false god. You can't talk about Thailand without talking about idolatry. As soon as you get off the plane, that's the number one thing when we would have teams come over. They would be like, whoa, because you're going to see huge golden statues of Buddha. You're going to see huge statues of demons. They have statues of demons because they want to pay respect to the demons so they don't get mad. They don't want them to get mad at them. And every piece of property from the mall to the gas station to homes in the neighborhood, they have a spirit house on that property. It looks like a big bird house or a doll house maybe. And that's where they want the spirits to go to live. They want to put food and put offerings in these spirit houses so the spirits won't mess with them in their house. Their whole concept of religion is based off of fear, of placating or having to buy off these spirits and these gods so that they don't get them. There is no relationship. There is no type of love or grace or any of those type of concepts. It's about, I got to pay these guys off or else they're going to make life difficult for me. It's totally fear-based, and it's heartbreaking. You'll go by, and we would see people, and they would come out in the morning, and they would take bananas or something and lay it in front of their spirit house and bow down and pray, hoping, just yearning. They're obviously spiritual people seeking things, but they're seeking idols who cannot talk, and idols who cannot hear, and idols who can do nothing. And so that's what's so heartbreaking, the idolatry that you see there. But we also see that idolatry is what we have to overcome in every country, including our own. Idolatry is the core of our sin that takes us away from God. We constantly want to make God like us. We want to shape God to be what we want him to be, instead of allowing him to shape us to be like him. You know, Scripture tells us that we were made in his image, but idolatry is the exact opposite, where we make images to be what we want them to be. It is the exact twisting, the perversion of the truth of us becoming like the living God. And I can remember I was in a migrant camp. I was sharing on a tarp with this guy named Sunjay. And up came a naysayer. Anytime you share the gospel, there's always going to be naysayers. I tell my guys, and this is true for us here today, anytime you share the gospel, whatever the setting, it always takes courage. It always takes courage because there will be opposition. And so we as Christians have to be ready. And so I'm sharing with this guy, and a naysayer comes up and he says, don't believe what this guy is saying. This is the white man's religion. You know, he believes it, his parents believe it. That's okay. They're white people. They're farongs. That's the Thai word for white guy. It's also kind of their word for potato. So that'll tell you what they think of us. I'm a big potato head. But that's their word. This is the white guy's religion. His family believe that. It's okay for him, but not for you, because you're Buddhist. You're Thai. Your ancestors believe this. And if you left that, you'd be leaving your cultural identity. You'd be going against your nation. You'd be going against your ancestors. And that shows you the mindset of what they're thinking. I told as I'm talking with Sunjay and this naysayer that came up, I said, well, wait a second. That's not true. This is not just the religion of one person. You have to remember that Jesus was not white, that Jesus was not European, that he was born in Bethlehem. As the prophet said, from the line of David, that he is a Jew. He's an Asian, just like the Thai people. And that starting with Jesus, he would pass that commission to share the good news to his disciples, and they would take the gospel all over that region of the Middle East and into Africa and eventually into Europe, and it would make its way to Rome, and from Rome to England, from England to the New World, North and South America, and then we would send missionaries to places like China and Thailand and India, and we see that the gospel has gone around, that it is not the gospel of just one people, that it is a gospel that has been carried on throughout the generations to go all the way around the earth. And I told him, I said, look, if you go back far enough, my ancestors, they were worshiping rocks and trees and who knows whatever else. But somebody shared with them the good news, and they believed. And that is the same pattern that we see in our world, that we must carry on. We must overcome idolatry and this idea that we want to make God like us. And we must recognize the God of the whole earth and take him and to share him with all that we can. But in idolatry, we want to justify ourselves. You know, the Vikings, they made gods that liked war and plunder because they liked war and plunder. The Greeks and the Romans, their gods like to party and sleep around because that's what they like to do. Even an atheist, they want to be the god for themselves. But the God of the Scripture rejects this totally and says that we must become like him and be holy. And I'll tell you what I've seen as I've come back is a dangerous precedent as I see even conservative Americans begin to try to shape God and who he is to be more accommodating with the culture. You know, I've joked with some pastors here in Robertson County that I feel time capsuled. Because we were gone for eight years, and we'd come back for some visits, but as far as our daily life being American, you know, we were kind of taken away for 8 years. It's amazing what's happened in 8 years. When we left, gay marriage was not legal. All the transgender discussion, that didn't exist. 8 years ago, we didn't even talk about that. The relationship between the public and politicians and the media, that has all drastically changed since we left. Very different. Race relations and how people look at looting and rioting and people's interaction in different communities, all that's changed just over 8 years. And my dad's got a saying, we should never be shocked when people that don't know Jesus act like they don't know Jesus. So we should expect it from the lost world that they would seek to not be like the Lord. But what has been shocking is how I've seen so many Christians, so many people who say they are followers of Jesus, that want to twist the gospel or reshape it to fit into the culture more and to be more acceptable. They compromise the truth in an effort to try to avoid persecution and in order to fit in. And what we see is this is idolatry. This is where we're trying to shape the living and true God to be what we want Him to be. And this is not right. I know this is an important thing that an individual must overcome, because this is a part of my testimony. Is I grew up a cultural Christian. I'd go to church every now and then. I knew when you were supposed to stand up, when you were supposed to sing, and when you were supposed to be quiet. But I never had a relationship with the living God. It was just something, just something to do. I had my Bible that I got when I was 13, but I didn't have a relationship with the Lord. I was living the beer commercial, is what I always say. My goal was to party and have a good time and have lots of friends and have as many girlfriends as I could. And you know what? My God was okay with that. My God was happy with me living that way. And I can remember being at college and meeting an atheist, and I was like, I'm going to beat that guy up for not believing in God. Because that's what Jesus wants us to do, right? Is beat up people that don't believe, right? That's the way we win them, is through brute force. Well, that just shows you what I was thinking. I had created a false God that I was living by, who was okay with everything that I was doing. And I was living that life. Until one Saturday morning, I hit rock top. I didn't hit rock bottom. I hit rock top because I was doing everything I wanted to do. I was successful by every measure that I had. I was living that life. I was doing it. I was successful at it. But I was miserable. I had no peace. I had no joy in my life. I remember looking in the mirror and just feeling paper thin. There was nothing to my life. And for the first time really in my life, I went into my dorm room and I got down on my knees and I prayed. And I said, Jesus, I don't even know if you're real. I don't know what I believe. I don't know what is true. I don't know anything. But I'm hurting. I need help. And in that moment, I felt the presence of the living God, of Jesus, in that dorm room. I didn't see anybody. I didn't hear any voice. But I felt the presence of God so strong that I was afraid to open up my eyes. That I had this sense of fear, but also of comfort at the same time. And I felt the Lord telling me that everything was going to be okay, but that my life was going to change. And I got up and I literally wiped off the dust of that Bible that I had gotten when I was 13 at church and had never read. And I began reading the Gospel of Matthew, and I got to the Sermon on the Mount, and I just felt God talking to me, going through each of those steps. And what I tried to do is I tried to negotiate with God. And I said, well, I'll do this, but I don't know about this. And it's okay, I'll do this. And for 3 days, I hardly slept or ate, and I was just negotiating with God. I was trying to say, well, I'll stop doing this, but I don't know about this. And what the Lord told me over and over again was that He would be the Lord of my life, or He would be nothing at all. That there would be no compromise of the truth. That He would be the Lord of every area or nothing at all. And so finally I surrendered. Finally I said, you are God and I am not. He is Lord. He is the one that we must obey and follow. And so maybe today, maybe some of you are in the same situation I was in. Maybe you've been doing this church thing and you've got it down of what the Bible is and when to stand to sing the songs, but you don't really have a relationship with the living God. Well, today can be that day, that the Lord is not far off, that those who seek him will find him, and that we can have a true relationship with the God of the universe, the God who loves us and died for us on the cross, the living God who rose again on the third day. We can have that personal relationship with Jesus. And so that leads us to the third thing I want to talk about, final thing, is we see at the end of this passage this call for all the gates to be opened, all the gates to be opened up so that the King of Glory can come in. And that's our prayer. That's our prayer for every nation, for every neighborhood, and for every heart, that the gates would be opened up and that they would know the King of Glory, that he is the Lord Almighty. I was pondering a thought a while back. It's one of the things that really helped me change the way I viewed missions and the way I viewed our role. Is I began to think that all my life I had thought that, well, Jesus died for me. And that's true, but that's not the best statement. The best statement is that Jesus died for us, of which I am a part. Because when we focus on, well, Jesus died for me, that makes me the end result of the cross. But the end result is not just my salvation, not just your salvation, but the salvation of people from every nation around the world. We're a part of that, and we can celebrate that. But it doesn't end with us. It must continue on. That we must be that link in the chain and carry it on. Paul, in the book of Romans, he wrote, I am debtor to both the Greeks and the barbarians to share the gospel to them. He said, I'm a debtor. I owe it to them. I owe it to these people. I don't know them. Paul had never met these Greeks and barbarians before. He said, I owe it to them because someone shared the gospel with me. I'm a link in that chain and must continue that on. That because someone shared with me and I believed, I owe it to others to be a light for the good news. I owe it to others to be a part of that chain that God started all those years ago in Jerusalem, and that it would carry on. So whether you're in Ridgetop or Bangkok or anywhere in between, that we want that message to carry on. We want the truth of Jesus to echo throughout the earth. I want to praise your church for a second, for being a part of giving to Lottie Moon. That goes to missionaries like us. When we served, we were supported by the Lottie Moon offering and gifts to the cooperative program. And let me tell you, we were taken care of. We just want you to know that we appreciate it. We worked with a lot of other great missionaries from other organizations and things, and they did great work. But after 6 months, they would have to go back home because they had to raise funds. And then when they came back, they were starting over from zero each time. But we didn't have to do that because we were supported by Lottie Moon. And so we were able to stay there, and our ministries didn't have to stop and start, but they were able to continue on. And so I want to thank you for being a part of that and encourage you to continue giving to Lottie Moon, because it makes a real difference to put missionaries on the field and for the gospel to go out into all the earth. But let me challenge you with something here today. Is a lot of times when we would speak at churches and I would talk with people, they'd say, hey, we appreciate what you're doing over there in Thailand. You're on the front lines of missions. And I'd always say, well, that's half true. We were on the front lines in Chiang Mai, but you guys are on the front lines here at Ridgetop, right? This is the front line here. If we're going to reach the people here in this community, it's going to be you guys. And so we're all missionaries. Our gifts may be different, our callings may be different, but the purpose is the same, that we would reach everyone, that we would be able to share the gospel to everyone we can so that some might believe and come to know the truth of Jesus. And so you guys are frontline workers here in Ridgetop. So pick up that challenge, accept that challenge, that it's your role in the kingdom to reach this community. And I thank you for being a part of what God is doing all throughout the world, in this association, in this county, in this state, in this nation, and ultimately all throughout the earth. Be a part of God's plan and what he's doing. I'll leave you with a couple of thoughts here. Just some. When we talk about missions, you can't talk about missions without talking about the great commissions, Matthew 28, go and make disciples of all nations. And that was a command that Jesus gave to his disciples. It wasn't a suggestion. It wasn't, hey guys, I got a cool thought. What if we did this? It's a command that we're to go and make disciples of all nations. But there's another verse that I like to pair with that, and that's from Revelation chapter 7. Because in Revelation chapter 7, we get a picture of the future of the throne of God. And it tells us that before the throne of God, there is a multitude so large that no one can count, from every nation, from every tribe, from every people, and from every language. And so what we see when we put these two verses together, we see that the Great Commission is a command. But Revelation chapter 7, before the throne, that is a promise. We see that God is going to accomplish His commission. He's going to do it. But the question is, will we be obedient? Will Ridgetop First, will this church be obedient to being a part of what God is doing? That's our challenge, to join Him in His work and what He is doing. When we left for Thailand, we got some strange questions. One was, are you taking your children with you? And we'd always say, well, yeah, they're coming with us. I mean, we're not going to leave them on the street. But the other question, you know, people would say is, well, do you have to go to Thailand? And we would always say, well, no, we don't have to. We get to. What a privilege to represent the Lord. And I told my Thai friends when we were coming back here to accept this position, they said, well, do you have to move to Tennessee? And I said, I get to move to Tennessee. And so when we think about being an ambassador for Jesus, when we think about being a witness, don't think I have to. Think I get to. What a privilege to represent the living God to the people around you, to your families, to your neighbors, to your coworkers, to your classmates, that we can be a light that shines to this world. Thank you all so much for having me today. Let me pray for us. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for its truth, that you are the God of the whole earth, of everything, and of all who live in it. And Lord, we marvel at your grace, that you would think to reach out to our people and that we would have the privilege of hearing the gospel. And Lord, help us to continue that on with sharing with others. Sharing here locally, but then also globally. Lord, we praise you for your truth. Lord, help us that we would turn away from idols and false gods, and that we would be submissive and be surrendered to the living Lord. And Lord, help us to be a people that are gate crashers, that are opening up the doors so that the King of Glory might be known. Lord, we thank you for this time. We pray that your word would be hidden in our heart so that we might not sin against you. And so, Lord, may your blessings be upon this congregation, on this church, as they seek to serve you. We just ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you'll stand. This is, you heard the invitation. This is the time of commitment where we commit our lives. Debts did. God, whatever, wherever, however, your Lord, I'll go. I'll do. Maybe it's to finally believe in Him. Maybe it's to be a part officially be a part of this congregation. Maybe it, whatever it is, won't you respond to that? Won't you come?
everyone. For those of us who are visiting, my name is Miranda Stoops. I am the Children's Ministry Director here. So I'm just going to let you know about a few things that we have going on. And because they gave me the microphone, I'm going to announce one of my favorites first, which is our young adult group that meets at 7 o'clock on Monday nights at Golly G's. Unfortunately, some of you are excluded. It's not for the young at heart. It is for the physically young, ages 18 to 30. So invite anyone you know who falls into that category, whether they go to this church, they're in your family, they go to another church maybe, but they need some fellowship that is not of the geriatric nature. We would love to provide. I am the oldest one in that group, if that's any consolation. We're going through the book of John. We would love to have them. If anything else, I will buy them coffee. Tell them to come. After that, we have our business meeting coming up January 16th to talk about ongoing things happening in our church. In addition to that, we have divorce care, which is going to be starting back January 20th. Teresa Esslinger is going to be leading that. So if you know anyone who is walking through that journey or is still coming back from that sort of event in their life, we would love to have them. We would love to minister to them. And that will be a great time, meeting on Thursday nights. On January 30th, we are having a family game night. Now, this is not a game night for families. This is for the family of Jesus. So everyone is invited to come and enjoy a good time together and do something decidedly not spiritual and just enjoy each other's company. And then for the kids who are here and who have been coming, we are starting a new program next week called our Superstar Program. So if you are between first and fifth grade, starting next week, we're going to have a poster. That's right, Camber, this applies to you. We're going to have a poster with your names on it, and every time that you fill out a notes sheet, every time you bring your Bible, and every time you bring a friend, you can get a little star sticker next to your name, and for every 5 stars, you get to pick out a prize. Ooh. Yes, and you don't get it if you don't come, so you should do that. And lastly, we have our Lottie Moon offering. We are already 59% of the way through our goal to 1,200, which is amazing. So far, as of today, we have $709.74. I think by the end of January, we can easily make that last bit. So I would encourage you, as you hear the stories of our missionaries from Thailand today, they are just one family that we have had the privilege of supporting, as so many take the gospel into places where it is not known. So please join us in that. And that is all for today. So if you would rise up for prayer, we're going to have Glenn give our closing prayer.